Thank you, Pooja. So as Dr. Pant, I think he took us through the evolution of technology as he's seen it. I think all of us have seen how technology has evolved and the pivotal role that technology is playing in our life and transforming the way we work. Now, could you have imagined what would have happened if the pandemic had struck us, let's say just 5 years ago? I think we would have all been paralyzed. It's just that advances in communication technology, Zoom, Teams, and whatnot, have enabled us to ride through the storm almost as if, you know, it didn't exist. Of course, the suffering was immense, but that was suffering from the disease. But when it comes to continuing our interactions and our work lives, it's really technology which really helped us, you know, through this period. And this has been evolving. All of you know of the various revolutions, you know, which have happened, industrial revolutions. Today, we are at the cusp of what we call as the fourth industrial revolution, where data is emerging as a key resource. It's becoming very, very fundamental. The only difference between data as a resource and our traditional resources, you know, like men, money, material, labor, and so on, is that our traditional resources are almost invariably always scarce. On the other hand, data is available in abundance. And what makes us successful is our ability to extract meaning from that data, and that is where technology really helps us. So when we're looking at, you know, the current revolution, it's data which is driving the change, and things like artificial intelligence is now actually becoming center stage. Now, AI has been there for a long time. It's not something which is new. I remember in the late 80s and early 90s, we used to toy with systems called expert systems, you know, which were really, you know, the manifestation of machines trying to do things the way human beings did. But there were a huge amount of limitations at that time in being able to perform the way machines are able to perform today to provide human-like behavior. And there are basically three important developments, you know, which have taken place, which has allowed us to do that. Number one is the availability of affordable computing. You know, with the cloud, data is there, you can extract it at any point in time, fairly, relatively cheaply. And so, one is the availability of affordable computing. The second is the availability of large amounts of data. So whatever you're saying, whatever you're speaking, sensors, what you do on your mobile phones, everything is getting captured and getting stored somewhere. And so you have large amounts of data which is available for us to extract and make meaning out of. And that extraction and making meaning is done through algorithms. So available on these computing algorithms. So when you have these algorithms which are able to access large amounts of data cheaply, you are able to therefore perform things which human beings could perform. And some of the tasks the machines can perform in a more superior fashion than even human beings. So tasks which can be automated, you know, are the tasks which can be performed better by machines. But there are many things which human beings can do much better than machines. And as we look at our lives going forward, we have to coexist. Machines and human beings have to coexist. And so we need to develop skills that allow us to be superior. Because when you go to the work environment, those are the skills which will get valued, you know, in the workplace. Some of the skills which we had earlier, you know, which had to do with things like clerical tasks, for example, would no longer be valued simply because machines can do them far better, more efficiently, and in a more superior manner. So there is this abundance of data, I think, which we must recognize. You know, I was talking to the CTO of Zomato. All of you must be using Zomato. And he was telling me that they gather 1 petabyte of data every day. You know what a petabyte is? Right? 1,000 terabytes, 10 to the power of 15 bytes. You know, just to give you a sense of what that is that if you were to play your normal music, you know, which you normally play, you would continue to play it for the next 2,000 years if you had 1 petabyte of music. So that's the amount of data which gets generated. And so they're building now algorithms to make meaning out of that data so that they can provide a superior service, you know, to their customers in a human-like manner. And what they're saying is that, you know, this interface that we have, which is your mobile, is not the most effective interface for a large proportion of the population, because you need to be educated. Communicating, voice is a far more effective method of communicating. And so how do you distinguish between, somebody wants to order a chicken, how do you distinguish between murgi, murga, chicken, or in South India, you know, somebody would say kodi, with different accents. All that is being done by analyzing data so that we can provide you with a superior experience. So, now to analyze data, you need to develop some skills. And here is where you need to, there's no escaping. By the way, irrespective of your background, whether you're arts, social sciences, science, there is no escaping from maths and statistics. So that's going to be a fundamental foundation that you need to develop knowledge around if you want to pursue and build a career around technology, because data is going to be central, and almost every application would require you to analyze that data and extract meaning from that data. But as we've seen, you know, technology evolves, and the hard skills, you know, that you acquire, you know, they're going to get obsolete very rapidly. And I heard, you know, again, Dr. Pal talk about the fact that you have to constantly keep learning. You have to constantly keep learning hard skills, because what you've learned and what you will learn in your MCA program, probably a year or 2 years later, you may have to think of something else as far as hard skills are concerned. But there are skills which are soft, which makes you special as a human. That's going to be equally important for us to learn and develop. Simply because you're not going to be sitting in a room alone by yourself and doing coding or building systems or building applications. You're going to be interacting with human beings. And so you need to develop those human skills that enables you to interact with human beings in a better way. And so these skills relate to, for example, creativity. Human beings are far more superior at creativity than machines. Alright? The ability for you to do critical thinking, look at multiple perspectives to arrive at a solution is far superior than that of a machine. And then machines have no emotions, right? The human beings are basically a bundle of emotions. And you cannot ignore emotions in your interactions. And so, machines can be intelligent. So they can have an IQ, but they cannot have, and will not have, at least for a long time as far as I can see, an EQ, which is an emotional quotient. And an EQ, which is the awareness of emotions, is very important, because when you interact, you are basically looking for a good experience. Alright? I mean, if you look at any business or a service, you're not really actually selling a product. You're not actually selling a service, but you're selling an experience. Why do you pay more for a Mercedes-Benz as compared to a Maruti? It's not just the product. Of course, the product is superior because it has many more features. But it's the overall experience. So if you look at the product features and the cost associated with those product features, it may be more. But the experience, because of the aspirational value of a Mercedes-Benz, is far superior, because that's an emotion which that organization as a company really targets at. So their communication, their advertising, and whatever else they do helps build that aspirational value so that you can get that emotional experience. So understanding emotions is something which human beings do in a much better way. Not in a much better, far superior to that of machines. Likewise, interactions, interpersonal skills. Right? How many of you have interacted with automated voice response system? You know, when you go to a call center, you get press 1 to do this, press 2 to do this. Right? You get pretty fed up with that interaction. On the other hand, if there is a human being on the other side, you get a far superior experience in that interaction. So interpersonal skills are very, very important in delivering that superior experience, which is something that, again, a human being can do much better based on the tone of communication, based on the body language, and various other things. Not that it cannot be programmed, it can also be programmed in computers, but the nuances associated with interpersonal communication are far superior in human beings. And then there is the whole issue of making judgments. I heard both Arpit and Dr. Pal talk about your value systems, right? Judgments, difficult decisions, you often rely on your value system to help you take those decisions. And you may, when you get stuck, for example, let's say it happens a lot in this country when you're interacting, let's say, with a government organization and making a sale. Okay, the person on the other side expects some favors. Now the judgment is, do you give that favor or you don't? Implications are, if you give a favor, things will happen simply. If you don't, it will take a little more effort, right? But then you rely on your value system, you know, to take that call. And so those kind of judgments, again, are things which human beings make better. That's what makes you a better human being and a better professional. And all these help you become a better leader. And so leadership skills are again something, you know, which a machine will find it extremely difficult to emulate. Because a leadership skill involves creating an aspiration for the team, an inspiring vision, and then aligning that whole team to that vision to deliver superior results. Again, something which human beings can do in a far superior manner. So the reason why I'm sharing this with you is that, as you know, even Professor Pal said, you have to constantly keep learning hard skills. Alright? What you learn today, in fact, you have to unlearn a lot of things that you've learned. And by the way, unlearning is far more difficult than learning. Alright? Because you don't want to let go. You've invested so much time, energy, and effort in learning a certain skill, and now somebody is saying it's, you know, no use, you have to let go of it. You keep hanging on to it. Very often, you know, I've spoken to professionals and asked them, you know, would you want to do some HTML programming? So, no, I'm a back-end programmer, you know, I do C, C++. And then when I explained to them, listen, the value that you add on the front end is far more than the value that you add in the back end. So if you do HTML and front end programming, you will have better value for your client or your customer. Reluctant to let go because he's learned that, doesn't want to give it up, and to learn something new and compete with new people. So unlearning is very difficult. So hard skills, you will have to unlearn and learn something new all the time. Okay, so you have to be in a mode of continuous learning. On the other hand, soft skills are something which are permanent and become an integral part of your personality. Alright, so all the things, you know, which I talked about, whether it is creativity or critical thinking or emotional quotient or leadership skills or you know, whatever else, interpersonal skills, these you have to consciously work on and develop. Alright, it's very, very important because ultimately in your workplace, you are going to be required to deliver a superior experience. And that superior experience will not just come from your hard skills, but the way you interact, the way you present yourself, the way you convince the other person on your point of view, and all those require soft skills. So, active learning, embracing change, and developing your personality and soft skills are going to be the hallmark of the professionals in the future, for which educational institutions provide multidisciplinary education. And I was happy to hear Sunil talk about the fact that we have both arts and science and, you know, all this as part of the curriculum, because you not only need hard skills, but you also need these soft skills and an appreciation of other aspects to help you with your critical thinking. Professor Pant gave so many nice examples from biology, alright? You may not be taught biology, but you know, look at the relationship between all those examples to what is happening in real life. So your appreciation of things in the real life will happen when you look at alternate subjects, arts, fine arts, in addition to the hard skills, you know, which you will acquire as a professional. In the real world of technology, one of the subjects which is becoming very, very, I would say, important is the whole area of design thinking. Alright? And so when you're building applications, it's not your understanding of Python or R or XYZ. It is how that application is going to deliver a better experience to the person who's going to be using it. And for that, the skill required is design. And design thinking is all about understanding the problem. In fact, you know, as engineers, and it was my own experience also as an engineer, we are eager to give a solution. Alright. But design thinking says, hold it. We'll worry about the solution later. Later, let's first understand the problem. And in fact, recommends that 70% of your effort should go in understanding the problem. Because if you don't understand the problem, you may give a solution to the wrong problem, it may be of no use. Now, to understand the problem, you need a lot of soft skills. And so design thinking is all about, you know, understanding human behavior, because ultimately you have to deliver a good experience. Everybody is looking for a superior experience. You're not looking for a product, you're not looking for a service, you're looking for a great experience, for which, you know, understanding human beings are very important. Now, all of us, you know, have a certain capacity of understanding, a certain capacity of knowledge. But when you go out in the real world, what is expected from you is much more than your capacity. So if your capacity of delivering an output is X, what is expected from you is X cubed or X to the power of 5. Question is, how do you deliver X cubed or X to the power of 5 if your capacity is only X? Right? The only way to do that is to make sure that everybody else around you is also helping you, so that it multiplies your own abilities. And the way to do that, and this is very important, the way to do that is to build strong relationships. Very, very important in your professional life is to understand this. It's very often, it's not what you know or how much you know that matters, but who you know. And that's very important. And building relationships is another very, very important skill. Very important skill. Now, how do you build relationships? Look at your own lives, whether it's a personal relationship or a professional relationship. There are two things that you need to focus on. One is trust, and the other is mutual respect. If any one of these two elements, if there is no trust or there is no respect, you don't have a relationship. So you need to work on, alright, if you want somebody to support you in a time of need or even otherwise, you need to build that trust and you need to build that respect. If you give trust, you'll get trust. If you give respect, you'll get respect. And most successful people, if you look at successful people around the world, have been successful not because of their degrees or what they've learned, but the relationships that they've built. This is very, very important for you to understand. And I'm just emphasizing on this simply because, you know, when you do your MCA program, definitely you will acquire a lot of hard skills. But those hard skills are going to be obsolete pretty soon. What you need to work on are really on your soft skills, which include all the things which I talked about, and building strong relationships. These are, you know, certain qualities that each one of you will have to develop in yourselves. I think both Arpit and Professor Pant already told you that you guys are very lucky, you know, that you are at this stage in your life. And I can say, you're even luckier because you're in this industry. I'm assuming all of you are going to be part of the technology industry. To my mind, this industry has embarked on its next golden phase. The last time we had experienced such a golden phase was in the year 2000. I don't think anyone of you were born in 2000. But the year 2000 was a turning point for the tech industry in India, because there was a problem which the world was trying to solve, which was the year 2000 problem. Alright? It was called the Y2K bug. Because all computers at that time were programmed, and when the year changed from 1999 to 2000, programs would start misbehaving because they were not programmed to deal with that number change, that date change. And so the entire industry got together to fix that problem, and that created the golden year. We have another bug which is creating the golden year for the industry, which is the COVID bug. Because the COVID bug has forced everybody to stay at home, and because people are staying at home, how do you interact? The only way to interact is virtually. And so, every organization, every business in the world has had to advance their digital transformation program. And that is what is creating this huge demand. So you are now entering into another golden period for the industry, where there will be enormous opportunities for each one of you. I saw a report by the World Economic Forum which said that technology is going to erode 75 million jobs, but it's going to create 133 million new jobs. So the way to address that opportunity is to build skills associated with those new jobs. And so this future lies with all of you, and I would say this future belongs to all of you who not only develop hard skills, but also the soft skills. So all the best for your future.